And here we go. Welcome to another episode of Funky Marketing Show. Today, I have a pleasure to host somebody who is very close to me when it comes to what he does, from which perspective he looks at the things, and somebody who is, you know, around here originally from Europe. We're going to talk about content, about SEO, how SaaS companies are doing it all wrong. But before we jump into all that, prepare your questions and we're going to listen to the funky intro. Back, guys, join me in welcoming to the show George. George, man, welcome to the Funky Marketing Show.
Oh, it's very good to be here, and I love this intro. I love, in general, the aesthetics of your brand. They are unusual, let's say. And thank you very much for the introduction. I'm really glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad to have you here. I mean, I remember how we met. And it's always interesting to me because I was celebrating my birthday on a Hey Growth Summit, and they moved me a lot further on the way. And your session was before mine, and you were, you know, going above the time that they have told me, and I was getting nervous because like there were people waiting for me because, you know, I'm celebrating my birthday, and I was like.
Man. Yes, sorry about that. I just had some things that I needed to cover back then. But I think that at the end, you know, it worked out well for all of us.
Yeah, for sure, man. And I love, because I'm usually that guy as well that gets into those gems, and I don't get out of them until I explain what I wanted to explain. So, tell me and everybody who's listening a thing or two about you, about what you guys do, what are your focus at, and how did you get to that point?
Sure. So Minuttia is, in a very broad sense, a marketing agency. We help B2B SaaS companies accelerate organic growth, and we help them do that through content marketing and SEO. We started the company almost 2.5 years or something like that. We are at the point now that we have 10 people and we have 10 more positions. So if anyone is listening and, you know, is looking for a job, and you think that, or you know someone who is looking for a job, feel free to check out our careers page and apply to any of the positions if you think that you would like to join our team. And so we started the company with the goal of helping B2B SaaS companies because I had my early experiences, let's say, in marketing were with SaaS companies. So it made sense for me to focus on that specific target audience. And I must say that we've been pretty successful, actually, in what we do. The company is growing, and it has been purely organic so far. In a few weeks from today, we will also relaunch, let's say, the brand. We are, you know, we have an amazingly and beautifully looking new website, and everything around the brand will change. So I'm very, very excited about that. Besides Minuttia and the work that we do with our beloved clients, we also have the SaaS SEO Show, which is a podcast, which is, you know, a podcast that I'm the host, and I interview some of the best minds in the industry, and we discuss topics around content marketing and SEO. And the podcast is sponsored by Ahrefs, which is one of the biggest, if not the biggest tool when it comes to SEO. And we're just trying to advance the conversation around content marketing and SEO and try to bring new perspectives into the conversation. And I think that we are doing a pretty decent job. Even though it started as purely a podcast, it develops, as I see it right now, into a kind of a separate arm of the company, maybe a completely separate entity, because it's going really well. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, I like how that sound is the same thing that's happening to us with Funky Marketing Show. But I want to ask you one thing, because it's always interesting to listen to the answer, because a lot of people have different answers, a lot of different companies. What made you rebrand and change your brand? What were the some signs that you saw that you need to do it?
I will tell you, and I will share as many things as I can, but I will not give you everything, of course.
Of course.
We saw the need for a rebrand because, to begin with, what we had done initially almost 2.5 years ago isn't representative of who we are today. Okay.
You've grown as a company, right?
Yeah, it's not representative. It's also not representative of the fact that we are a premium service and we work with some of the biggest SaaS companies in the world. And the truth is that this doesn't reflect on our website. Okay. And exactly because we have many big companies visit on our website on a weekly basis, we want who we are right now to be reflected on our design, our logo, our copy, everything. And this is not the case with our current website. So I think that it's a no-brainer. And at the same time, I must admit that we even delayed it. And the delay is definitely on me, because I guess that I didn't have time, or I didn't prioritize it high enough, because things were happening so fast. They still happen so fast, but at this point I have the luxury of time, because I've pulled myself out of operations to be able to focus on our new website and brand and how we get perceived, not only by prospective clients, the general audience, but also, and I would say most importantly, by our existing clients, companies who do business with us and who trust us, and who are there for us and support us every month. Okay, because we often forget about that, and we do things just for the sake of creating a great impression to a new connection, a new person, a new company, whatever. Definitely, we care about that, but I care about also about the fact that I want to be perceived as someone who, or as a company that develops and evolves from our existing clients. So in a nutshell, this is it. It's something that we had to do, and I'm really excited about it. Things will go live in the first half of October before we visit SaaStock. We will be improving, after that, since we will be launching, let's say, a basic version of the website with the pages that we have right now, and we have planned already for more pages to be added as we move forward.
Yeah, sounds good. I'm looking forward to seeing what you guys have thought of. I'm sure it's gonna be good. One thing that is on my mind always when I see somebody launch a new website, besides just coming up from what you were like a couple of years ago to what you are now, is also and it is something that I want to include in the further conversation, that often companies, especially SaaS and tech companies, they tend to lull into that feeling that we are growing, everything is good, we are growing with the market. But often what they don't understand at that point is that if they grow with the market, only with as the market grows, it means that they are already losing in the long run. It means that they are not innovating, they are not thinking of the new features, new perspectives, solving maybe different problems within that one that they are already solving. And for majority of them, what happens is that somebody who has already seen the bigger picture came up, from behind, comes up with a new website, comes up with a new feature, with the new products, and just dominate the category or the subcategory. And then basically it's gone. In a second, whatever they were building, it's gone. Somebody else came here and just took it over.
I agree with your main point. And I do believe that you have to be constantly improving, constantly learning, developing yourself. And if that includes caring about your brand, which is something, by the way, that you should do, regardless of whether you are a SaaS company or you are in professional services like us, you have to, and especially with agencies, what happens is that very often we do all this hard work for our clients and we forget about ourselves. You know, the truth is, the hard truth is that most agency websites, most agency brands, let's say, they are kind of neglected. And the reason is that, you know, we spend so much time, which is something that we should do, by the way. We are in professional services. We should do that. It's not that I advise against it, but we spend so much time doing client work and we completely neglect our brand. This is not exactly the case with us because we were doing some things, several things actually, on the brand side, on the content side. We were doing webinars, we had our podcast and so on and so forth. That's not entirely, you know, truth for us, but at the same time, it's at some point you have to take a step back and think, okay, when I started, you know, this website or brand or whatever, brand identity or whatever, they were okay for that stage. But now I'm in a completely different stage and I have to do something about it. And most importantly, if I don't have the time to do something about it, well, I have to find someone to help me. Okay, so we, for this rebrand, we as an agency, we work with two different agencies that, you know, help us with the design and development of the website, and a third person, a contractor for graphic design as well. So we are talking about three different, you know, let's say, I don't know, partners, okay? And we do that because we believe that, okay, we don't have the time. And in our case, we don't have the capabilities as well because we are not a development agency, but we don't have the time, okay? Does that mean that we have to leave it as it is for the next, I don't know, 5 years? No, this is not what we are going to do here. So as we suggest to our clients, like, you don't have the internal capacity and capabilities or expertise. This is why, you know, agencies exist, okay? This is why we are here. The same thing that we advise to other businesses, we do for ourselves. And I said four, because we also have hired one of the, if not the best copywriter for SaaS companies who is going to craft the copy for some of our pages. So all I'm trying to say is that, you know, you always have to take a step back and think about where you were and where you are and where you want to go as a business. And if you don't have the time to, you know, to do it yourself, that's fine. I mean, that's totally fine. As long as you accept the fact that you may have to ask for help from a vendor to help you, you know, do whatever you want to do.
Agree. That's so well said. And I'm so glad hearing that because, like, starting Funky Marketing, from the start, I said, like, we're going to act like Funky Marketing is one of our clients. So we're going to look at ourselves as our clients because that's the only way that we can leave time to work on our company, on our own brand as well.
That's true. I agree.
Okay, so let's get into the conversation that I see a lot of people are talking about. I had here on the show Emilia Korzinska or and Maeva and Erin Balsha and different people that we had a conversation around those things, around SEO, around content, but we didn't come up to specific things. Why are SaaS companies doing things wrong and what are the things that they are doing wrong? Because like there's a conversation going around should B2B companies, B2B tech companies do the SEO at all? You know, we as marketers and as people, we like to go to extremes and like to go like we go all in or we don't do it at all. So let's see what will come up out of these conversations and start from what are some things that SaaS companies are doing wrong when it comes to SEO.
That's a great question. I will start with a point you made on whether SaaS companies should invest in SEO in the first place. And I would say that this depends, you know, the decision that a SaaS company will make ultimately depends on several factors. One of them is you should take a look at competition. Can you see other competitors that have used SEO as an acquisition channel? If yes, if, for example, you are an email marketing software, yeah, you know that there is demand out there and you know that even though competition is very intense, there are people who are looking for solutions like yours. So in that case, search, organic search, and even paid search makes sense. If you are in a category that's relatively new and you are developing something entirely new where the way people search about that something hasn't been developed yet, which is not, I wouldn't say rare, but it's not happening every day, then SEO may not be the best channel for you. You may have to consider other things, other, you know, motions like sales, for example. Okay. But if SEO is a validated, let's say, channel, then I would say also, as I mentioned previously, there are many other factors that you need to take into account, but I would say that it makes sense. And it makes sense because let's not forget that especially when it comes to SaaS companies, CACs, customer acquisition costs, are on the rise. And SEO happens to be one of the relatively, I'm not going to say that it's cheap because it's definitely not, but it's one of the channels that can help you acquire new customers with a healthy CAC to LTV ratio, okay? So these are things that you need to consider. And I would say that based on our experience, of course, SEO can have a dramatic impact and can really change and transform a company, either a SaaS company or a B2B company. I can't speak about B2C because we are not as experienced there. But I think that it can really have a very big impact. Now, to your main question, what most SaaS companies do wrong and get wrong when it comes to SEO, I would say that the life cycle stage, the life cycle journey of a typical life cycle journey of a SaaS company is a bit obvious. And because of that, many people think that you know what? We know it. It's a matter of launching some alternative pages, some VS pages, then some best whatever tool pages, and call it a day, okay? Because it fundamentally, it is as simple as that, okay? So exactly because of that, many people think that, you know what, this is all there is, and let's do exactly that. And not only that, let's do it in a way that's similar to competition, so mm-hmm. that we can have chances of getting high rankings or, you know, whatever. The point is that most companies are trying to, quote unquote, manipulate the algorithm and have an algorithmic, let's say, approach when it comes to SEO, instead of trying to integrate opinion and perspective into their content and SEO efforts, okay? This leads us to the problem of what's nowadays called as copycat content. In general, I would say that this leads us to a homogeneity in the organic search results, where you see many results look like, you know, look like each other. And this doesn't really make for an effective strategy. And unless you understand that and you try to introduce another way of approaching things and doing things, even for some of the most obvious, you know, things on SaaS SEO, such as, for example, alternative pages, and I will give an example. Unless you do that and you are ready to take the extra mile to do that, I would say that it's a game that may have some positive returns right now, but with the way Google's algorithm and general understanding of content works and evolves, sorry, not works, but evolves, moving forward, you will not, you know, see the same results that you may see today. And when I mentioned an example about alternative pages, everyone can do an alternative pages. You pick, I don't know, 12 alternatives. You place yourself at the top of this list. You use a content optimization tool. That's it, okay? And call it, and hit the publish button. Not everyone could review, actually test, try 4 of these tools. You don't have to go on and review 12 of them just because other, let's say, pages and list posts on the top 10 have include, I don't know, around 12 list items. Just go on and actually try the 4 of them out, okay? Just try them and come up with an honest review about, you know, we've actually tried 4 Slack alternatives. Here's what we learned, okay? I think that people and ultimately Google will appreciate that more than having a piece of code that looks like every other piece of code out there, checks all the boxes when it comes to SEO best practices, and really feels plastic and not, you know, it doesn't have a unique perspective, an angle, an opinion that people can accept or not accept, okay? Because this is part of the game. Okay, you tried for tools, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to accept that. But I would say that this is way better than just copying other results and just doing generally what other websites and brands are doing. I would say that this is something that we published, or we are going to publish. I'm not sure. We are going to publish, or we have published already. I'm sorry, I don't really remember. A blog post on what we call algorithmic vs heuristic SEO. Algorithmic SEO is, we're just trying to, quote unquote, once again, manipulate the algorithm. While heuristic SEO is coming up with a unique approach to doing things, even if that means that we compromise on things like search volume or even demand, meaning that we don't really care whether people are looking for this or not. Just to give you an example, one of the examples that we give in that piece of content is CoSchedule's headline analyzer. They launched, I'm not sure if you're aware of that, and recently they turned that into a product, actually, because it has been tremendously successful for them. I can't remember exactly when they launched that tool, but my assumption is that they didn't launch that tool, or before they launch it, they didn't go to a keyword data provider to check, is there a demand for headline analyzer?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, have that guide their decision? I don't think they did that. All they said is that, you know what? We have this idea. We feel that this is something that, you know, could potentially have an audience, and we would like to try it out. And they did. And guess what? Go on and check Google Trends. We did that. This is why I bring this example up. Go on and check Google Trends for headline analyzer. No branded terms, no co-scheduled headline analyzer, just headline analyzer. And you will see that there is demand, search volume. People start searching for that after CoSchedule launched their headline analyzer. So in that case, they created demand. They didn't check a keyword data provider and they were like, oh, there is search volume for headline analyzer. And it seems that, you know, there is a CPC also, which means that this may be a great term. No, I don't think they did that. What they did is that, you know, based on intuition or their knowledge of the market or, you know, through talking with customers, I don't know, they launched it and they created demand for that. This is a bold move. It's something that most SaaS companies don't do nowadays. But because I have the luxury, let's say, of talking to a lot of people and knowing a lot of people, I get to see many results like this. And, you know, discuss many results like many examples, sorry, and cases like this very often. One that I liked from a guest that we have, that we will have in a couple of weeks on the SaaS SEO Show, comes from a company called Scribe. I think their website is Scribe How or something like that. And they launched recently, not a tool, but a collection, let's say, of user-generated content that they have in the subfolder Explore. If I'm not mistaken, it's scribehow.com/explore. I don't want to get it wrong, but you know, it's something like that.
Sort of like a hub of content, right? Something like that.
Yeah, exactly. And guess what? They did it, and they do it. They are heavily based on user-generated content, and obviously, this has one of the side, let's say, effects of that is that the tool is about helping you describe a process in a visually appealing way. Okay, so there are people who are looking for example, how to do this in Asana. And there will be a user of Scribe who happens to have this video uploaded in the Explorer library. And guess what? This also has the side effect of people are looking for it, and we also get some traffic for it. But this is not the primary goal. The primary goal is to create something that, you know, there doesn't exist right now. And as I was discussing with the company's head of content, who is amazing, by the way, you should have him on your show. This is something that, you know, they were surprised to see how great results they can have by launching this section. So in a nutshell, I would say that what's wrong with SaaS SEO Show is that because the journey is so obvious, people think that it's as simple as just covering every term and keyword that exists out there. And in a way that's kind of emulate what other companies and brands are doing. This is what's wrong. And I think that how will we get out there through heuristic SEO, which is something, by the way, that you will not find to any blog post or whatever. We use the term internally through heuristic SEO and not through tactics and methodologies that have the goal of manipulating, let's say, the algorithm and just get you rankings without or with little to no business impact.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you what it is specifically after this, but let me try to sum up some of the things that you said. So basically, to go and invest in SEO or no, it depends on if there is already a demand. If you are creating a new product in the existing demand, or you are creating a totally new product and creating basically a new category for which you don't have the existing demand, which means nobody's looking for that. And it's the case with a lot of, like, at least it was, with a lot of AI machine learning tools. When they started, now there, I guess there is a certain demand, but when they started, like, I don't know, a lot of different stuff, nobody was looking for that. So they needed to create demand in a new way, starting with a community or starting on social media or wherever you create demand. Because basically, if you look at how the things are, separate, create the demand and close the demand. Basically, SEO is close the demand channel, which is maybe not sales, but let's say pre-sales, because people already have the intent. So you need, if you have people who have the intent to find a tool to solve their problems and they are actively looking for it, then SEO is what you need to do. And if you look the things from that perspective, you are in a channel where possibly the category leader gets like 76% out of everything that's over there. That's just a stat. And so if you are not competing, creating new category, basically you can fight for the rest of it. So like 34% of it. And to actually win a large percentage of that, you need to differentiate. And you don't differentiate by doing what your competitors are doing, but you look at your competitors so you can see what they are not doing, what they are not covering, and how can you do things differently.
I would say that to your point, there's nothing wrong with targeting keywords. First of all, okay, there's
definitely nothing wrong with that.
But there is the point that I'm trying to make here is that the way you're doing it is what makes the difference. Okay, so go after keywords, but you don't have to do it in a purely, we're just interested in rankings and we will do what other companies and results are doing so that we can get the rankings. If you do it that way, especially with Google's enhanced understanding of whether or not the person who wrote a blog post actually is a subject matter expert, and with the release of the helpful content update, we see that Google will take action sooner or later for all like the content or most content out there that doesn't really demonstrate expertise, opinion, unique angles, perspective, and so on. I would say that this is what you should, focus on. Does that mean that we have to publish less content? Yeah, maybe. Does that mean that we have to pay more for content? Yes, maybe, depending on also your category, because you may have to, or you have to, not may have to, because, this is where things are going, by the way. You have to find writers, content creators, who are actually subject matter experts and not, compromise on quality because you pay less per blog post or whatever. So these are things that you need to consider. And to your point about whether companies should invest in SEO in the first place, I must say that, like as I mentioned previously, that this is just one of the factors. Another factor is how, what is your exact stage? Like, When a company is in a very early stage and is bootstrapped, for example, I don't think that the best use of their time, energy, and little to no money is SEO. I would advise against it, okay? Stage is one thing. Another thing is the fact that are you operating and competing against other companies that have used this channel as a as a traction channel. So many factors on whether you should invest in SEO or not. And in general, I must say that things are pushing towards a different direction when it comes to content SEO. Checking boxes of best practices, and you can see that as well, because even if we don't do that, Google is going to do it for us either way, meaning that I was reading a study, I think it's from Zippy, ZYPPY, about Google rewriting meta titles, title tags, okay? And they studied 80,000 pages or something like that, and they found that Google rewrote 61% of them, if I'm not mistaken. I'm sorry if the stat isn't right. You can visit the page yourself. But that's massive. And it shows us that, you know what, you may try to trick me because you think that I'm not smart enough. But at the end of the day, I will, you know, it's my property, first of all, and I will do things the way I want. So you may have a title tag, but I understand that the title tag should be query specific. So just so you know, or, you know, you may not know, I'm going to apply changes to that title tag so that it matches the searcher's intent, okay? So this is Google's way of saying that I'm going to take action. Either you like it or not, I'm going to take action. And the same thing happens and will happen with content and with every effort that has the goal of manipulating the algorithm instead of just introducing a new approach and the things that I mentioned earlier, perspective, different angles, opinion, and so on and so forth. I had a discussion with a person I admire the other day, and we were discussing that exact topic. And he told me that, let's say that you are into running, okay, and you are looking to buy new running shoes. Chances are that you're going to open Google and search for something that, like, in the lines of best running shoes for, I don't know, short distance or long distance or whatever, okay? And you're going to see a list post of several list posts with the best running shoes. Now imagine if someone, as I mentioned previously about the Slack alternatives example, someone goes on and actually tries, you know, three or four different pairs of running shoes, okay? Imagine how big of a difference that would make. And imagine if you see, as the searcher of that query on Google, I've tried, you know, four or five different running shoes for long distance. This is my take. I don't know about you, but I would choose that result. And I think that this is something that we will increasingly see and encounter as content professionals and SEO professionals in the future.
Yeah, I totally agree, and it's a very valid point. I remember, I think back in 2018 at a conference, I was doing a lecture on an SEO, and the thing that was the way I communicated it is content is basically customer research team. SEO is your customer research team, because that's how you find out those things. And I think to get it all back to start, that's causing all those good results that you mentioned, is talking to the customers and getting their point of view. One example I can name, we're working with a Turkish company, User Guiding. Basically, it's no code tool, it's onboarding tool that has multiple options and multiple features and help customers do multiple things. So they were thinking of how should they position themselves, you know, what's the name that they should go for, what are the queries, what are the keywords. So talking with customers from two perspectives. One is from the product side. Product is talking with them to see how the product goes. And the other is like customer success, to see how they're satisfied with the product, with the service and everything. And listening to those conversations, they found out that actually they are using five or six different ways to call the tool. the service what they're providing. So they were thinking, okay, so we don't actually need to go for one category, we can go and rank for the multiple ones. And knowing that, so based on the specific research and insights from the customers, they decided to build a media company and to produce. At one point, they have like 20 to 50 articles per month, pumping out content on all those different categories. And on majority of them, like project management, they are actually among the top three results right now based on those insights. But they talk to the customers. And I think a lot of companies don't actually do that. And that's a huge minus because they just assume things and they go. As you said, some of them don't even go and check out the trending things, what's happening over there, are there some traction for something. They just go and invest in it. It's okay if you just have a feeling that you need to go for these keywords or this category or whatever it is, but it's not based on just the, you know, feeling is not based just on thin air. It's based on some conversations that you have, some traction that you saw here and there.
I think that this is a very important point. There are three types of research you can do when it comes to SEO. The first, audience research. So you can try to identify what your audience looks like, what publications they visit, what YouTube channels they follow and subscribe to, what podcasts they listen to, and so on. Then there is keyword research, and you can do keyword research easily using a tool like Ahrefs, for example. It makes your life way easier. And then there is customer research that you just mentioned. The problem is that, which by the way could include everything from, you know, running customer service, conducting customer interviews, actually talking to your customers, analyzing customer support tickets, analyzing reviews on review sites like G2, Captera, GetApp, and so on, and even analyzing sales calls. Okay, so three types of research. The problem is that in most cases, SaaS companies focus on, and I would say that this applies not just to SaaS companies, but to every company out there. We focus too much on the first two, okay? Audience research and keyword research. There is nothing wrong with that, but as I see it, the ultimate source of truth is the person who pays for the service. So at the end of the day, you can trust what tools can tell you, and you can get very useful insights from these tools. While you're conducting audience research and keyword research. But unless you talk to your customers, you know, you don't really know, you assume. Not that this can't work in some cases, but based on my experience working with SaaS companies, talking to your customers can be really eye-opening. For example, A few months ago, we ran a customer survey with one of our clients, and we were really, when we started receiving the first responses, we were really excited, and it was really mind-blowing, let's say, to see that one point people were comparing us with other tools than, you know, the ones that we had in mind. We thought that our competitors are these ones, and these are the tools that our customers are using before us or are going to use after us if they are going to cancel the service. But guess what? In many cases, people pointed us to a completely different direction, and we were not even aware of these tools. Like, really? People are using these tools for doing this, you know, job that we help them, we also help them do. So this was a great point that we identified. And guess what? Like, this takes, I don't know, a couple of hours to design the survey using Typeform. And then you just, you know, wait and collect answers. Obviously, it helps if you incentivize answers and if you kind of push without being too pushy, but you kind of push people to, you know what, this is important to us. I would really appreciate it if you could take 2 minutes of your time and fill out the form. And it was mind blowing. And it really, by the way, it informed us, it informed our strategy, okay? Because it then helped us go to Ahrefs and search, having different, you know, a different level of insight as to what the customer is, who the customer is, what tools they are using, and comparing us against how they are verbally describing the tool and how they would search for it online, and all these other very useful insights.
But you mentioned one thing, and I saw it as we started to work with a B2B and SaaS companies, is that we saw that all of them have content on their website. And it's pretty decent content, but it's written only for SEO. As you said, it's, you know, doesn't have a point of view. It's not total leadership content. They bring something new, and that's the kind of content that they should be writing if they want to go towards decision makers, right? If they want to go to somebody who will, for example, use the product, or somebody who is just given a task from a decision maker or from the CFO to find a tool that they need for something like that, then it's a little bit different. But what we saw is then none of them have figured out the distribution. And so we said, okay, we can take that content and it's getting them traffic from Google. Okay, that traffic is not converting the decision maker, but they have a traffic and people are consuming it. So let's just take it, give it a point of view, personalize it based on where we are publishing it, and start creating demand with that content from social media, from different platforms. And it turns out that distribution is the one thing that's missing in a lot of companies, because they just don't have enough people to do it, or they don't know how to do it effectively. And on the other hand, realizing those stuff for us, for Funky Marketing, basically that's all we've done. Where we create content, we create it with distribution in mind. We already know who's inside the content. We know that if we include our ideal ICP, people that we want to have on our podcast, people with whom we maybe partner up, that they will be included in the distribution, and they will do their part of the distribution. When they do it, other people from the companies will see, and that's how we spread the message. And one thing that we didn't know at the time is that it will get us SEO results as well. Here I mean, like, take a podcast, publish it as video, as audio, create an article out of it, then have a, you know, publish it, republish it on Medium, you know, link it up from different platforms, and in time, it gets you the SEO results as well. From one single reason, and I think that's the most important thing that I want to emphasize, is focusing on the customer. You know, you create content just to help them get to the next level.
I think that what we need to understand is that the way we can distribute our content and the options that we have there are heavily based on the type of content. So you were talking about SaaS companies. We have, broadly speaking, three types of content. We have content that's created for a search audience, which, you know, is also known as SEO content, even though I don't subscribe to that term. So we have content that's created for a search audience. We have product-focused content, your product updates, your how-to guides, your everything, you know, that is focused on product. And then we have what we call at Minuttia original content, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, if you think about it, when it comes to product-focused content, and I will discuss a bit more original content, but if you think about it, you've got what are the options that we have when it comes to distribution. When it comes to product-focused content, chances are that you can distribute it just to your own media. For example, your email list, your own website, obviously, and things that, you know, belong to you. Because the truth is that people wouldn't be so excited to see your product update on social media, for example. And I don't think that they would amplify that. And at the same time, this is, in most cases, there is no SEO there. So we are talking about distributing product-focused content just in your owned media. How about content that's created for a search audience? Well, here you are kind of limited because the only place to distribute that content is organic search. And the truth is that even if you publish that content on social media, it will not get as much traction, okay? Because it's designed for, you know, it has a different objective, and that's fine. But I mean, don't expect that you will publish a list of alternatives on social media and, you know, people are going to be excited about it and, you know, talk about it and so on and so forth. Unless you do something, you know, different. And then we have original content, which includes things like personal storytelling, data studies, invented concepts, such as a piece of code written by HRs on the middleman method. We have, you know, anything that has to do with data, obviously. And in general, anything that brings up a unique perspective and angle, original research, contrarian content, you know, you are doing this wrong, here's how to do it right, and so on and so forth, okay? With original content, you have way more options and possibilities when it comes to distribution. It's obviously content that you can publish and distribute and promote to your own media. Definitely social media. Sometimes, not always, organic search, and that's fine. You know, the objective is not to get organic visibility, and there doesn't have to be a target keyword behind every piece of content that's original content that you publish out there. But you have so much more possibilities. For example, micro communities, subreddits, Facebook groups, Slack groups, and so on and so forth. And also, let's not forget, since we are talking about SEO, that in most cases, what happens is that original content is also the type of content that attracts links, backlinks. This is by design, okay? Yeah. This piece of content are designed to attract links. So you have so many possibilities there. So I would say that when it comes to distribution, it's about the type of content and understanding what are the, you know, the possibilities that you have for each content type. And we said that I just mentioned that there are three types of content, and each of them, you know, have their own limitations and their own options and so on and so forth. So this is how I see it when it comes to, you know, distribution of content for SaaS companies.
I totally agree. And it's one of the things that I see, you know, many people surprised when they come and ask for, you know, for content pieces. And we go in depth and ask what's the purpose of it. You know, because it matters so much to know what are you writing this for, who it is from, and what you want to achieve with this piece of content. But tell me, we are close to the end. What are some things that we didn't say, or some things that you want to say to kind of conclude the conversation?
I think that we said a lot, and maybe in some cases I prolonged, you know, I talked, but the thing is, the truth is that I get really excited about these things. I live them every day, and I think that we have the luxury, let's say, of being in the position to interact with and work with all these different companies, as opposed to having to work with just one company, one account, one, you know, everything one. So this is a unique position, and I'm really, really, really happy about it. So we talked a lot about a lot of different things, but if I had to emphasize one point, and I'm, you know, if I had to share one takeaway, that would be especially considering Google's way of taking action through an algorithm update, for example, such as the helpful content one. Try to add unique perspective, bring opinion, and in general, try to do things a bit differently. And even though that's kind of a hubris, let's say, to be said by someone who runs a con marketing and SEO company, but try not to focus as much on SEO. It's okay if the title tag is not perfectly optimized, or the meta description is not the best it could be. It's okay. It's fine. You know, it's really fine. And if you haven't scored a grade that's high enough in the content optimization tool that you're using, as long as you present a unique angle, something that's different than what other companies, brands, search results are doing.
Very, very well said. Guys, I suggest you now stop and go to the beginning of the episode and look everything from the start and make sure that you stop when you hear something interesting, because both George and I went into little gems and shared a lot of different stuff. All of them have a point and have sense. So make sure you go read, try to understand all of it. If you don't, like, reach out to George, ask him to clarify some things, to give you some examples. I'm sure he will gladly do that. And George, tell the people where they can find more information about you, about you know, about the agency, about the podcast. Sure. We'll leave the links below, but just make sure you're vocal about it.
Sure. So the agency, you can visit minuttia.com, but you can visit it, I would say, in the first half of October when we will have the new branding live. Don't visit it now. Visit it in October. So this is the website that we have, and make sure to follow our blog, because we publish really good content that you don't, you know, find in most agency websites, actually. Then make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel at Minuttia, where we publish the video version of every episode that we publish for the SaaS SEO Show. And also, we'll start being way more active when it comes to tutorials, discussions, and things that we feel will bring value to our audience. Subscribe to Apple Podcasts and Spotify so that you can follow and, you know, listen to the audio version of every episode. And if you want to connect with me personally, I would say the best place to do so is LinkedIn. If I don't get back to you, that would be because I get tons of messages and I'm not, you know, on LinkedIn every day. But eventually I will get back to you, and that would be it, I guess.
Yeah, man. Thanks to you again for spending an hour here with me, talking about things and sharing knowledge and insights. I'm sure we'll jump into recording one more session soon and get into more things. As I found out some of the things by trying them out with my different domains and a website, I'm sure I will want to have your point of view and opinion about it. And guys, for you, what I can say for the end, as always, keep it funky. That's always important. Have that funky edge to everything you do, and that's the road to success. Bye-bye, and see you in the next episode.